How many were there? 10 times. Yeah, we mentioned 10 times of forbidden activities. So, very important, you're cultivating, doing anushilan for bhakti. But then, along with that, because take note, this section is about anarthas, unwanted desires and like fumbling or obstacles, and obstacles to bhakti. So he's saying that we should endeavor to reject forbidden activities. Okay, so 10 forbidden activities. And yesterday, we among the 10, I think we only described the first one. Do you remember the first one? What's the first one? The first among the forbidden activities. Yes.
Association
with materialistic persons opposed to bhakti. Or in other words, association with like you know, we have to go to sadhusanga. Only with sadhus. And anything that is not sadhu, meaning opposed to bhakti, don't associate. Okay? So when it comes to associating with people opposed to bhakti, there are, as this we discussed yesterday, six types. Six types that we considered as bad association. Okay, what was the first one?
Immoral
atheists. They're not only atheists, but they're immoral. Okay? And usually, that's what happens with atheists. You know, you don't believe in God, you cannot not really be moral. But the second type is they're atheists, but they're moral. Moral meaning they follow like some
rules.
Yeah, rules which are they see like favorable for society and other people, but they're actually atheists. And then the third one is the moral theists. They believe in God and they follow morality. But why we avoid them? Why?
Because God is subordinate.
Yes, because they may believe in God, but in reality that belief of God by them is only their part of their morality. It's not like the main object of their life. You know? It's like, oh, we have to be good. He actually Bhaktivinoda Thakur tells two kinds of this kind of people. Two kinds. One is the karmis, who are using you know, their faith in God only as part of their like moral obligation, so that they get fruits of their pious actions. You know? So then the second one are those mainly yanis. They have some conception of or some faith, but it's actually for the purpose of like so then we become purified. So then later on we can be liberated, and after that, who needs God? No need for God like this. So that's the third one. And the fourth one? And there, for the fourth one, there's also two kinds. You were here yesterday, I forgot. But there's the like the cat-like, and there's the swan, that's one. The crane one, you know? Yeah, they are the hypocrite, so-called devotees, who are greedy. Meaning, they externally may try to pose like devotees, but the purpose of that is really to get some wealth, get some women, get some name and fame, like this. And some are even pretending to be devotees, even also to teach, even like atheism, or even to teach anything about like not like proper, you know, siddhanta or Vaishnavas, like this. So these are the four kinds, the hypocrites. And the fifth one, the Mayavadis. Mayavadis, we know. And sixth one, are they? What's the sixth one? Did we finish this discussing about the Mayavadis? We didn't finish this. We'll take it from here because I think we did not finish this. So the fifth one are the negotiation bodies. You know, they're propagating the teaching that God is not a person. Okay. There's Brahma, like there's some like spiritual existence, but that's only like it doesn't go like personalities. So well, this is absolute truth. Like there's Brahma. Actually, oh, you are Brahma. All of us are Brahma. And there's only Brahma. And the moment you you know, with that idea, it's like anything that has form is Maya. You know, because Brahma has no form. That's what their wish is. So according to their conception, so what are they teaching? What is their conception? That once the heart is purified by the performance of some sadhana, like bhakti and sadhana, then the tattva, meaning the truth, will be revealed. Which truth? That we are all Brahma. And then this is our liberation. You know, we become liberated. Okay. So, what is that mukti? That mukti means the destruction of the jiva. Like no more existence of the jiva. No, why? Because we merge to that oneness, no more individuality. So then everything attains a non-differentiated condition. This is called the nirvishesh condition. So according to this conception, both bhakti and Bhagavan are temporary. Because yeah, this is part of this. Remember, there was a discussion on this in the previous, in the very beginning, the first chapter, when we talk about like Mayava teaching, they never accept the teaching of transformation, right? You remember that? Transformation? What is the term for transformation? Parinam. You know, this Parinam Ba. They're against that one. Their conception is, what is it? It's not transformation, but the pure illusion. It's Vivartavad. Because when you say Brahma never, they say, Brahma is always the same, never changed. So then, how would you explain the jivas? You know? So it's like, actually the jiva is Brahma, but he's an illusion. It's just an illusion, but it's actually Brahma. So it's never a transformation. For one, they deny the existence of Shakti. Because really, there's only Brahma, no. They don't. So it's, that's why you can't explain this. That like for us, it is true, Bhagavan is always constant. You know? He is Nirvikar. But it is not that he is not a person. He's a person. But as Shakti, Shaktiman, Bhagavan is Shaktiman, his Shakti transforms. Shakti can manifest in so many ways for his service. But he remains independent, like never transformed. Okay, so they denied the existence of Shakti. And so then they made up this the whole philosophy that we the jivas, we are the divarta, just like we are Brahma, but an illusion. But if you think about that, it's actually absurd, because how Brahma becomes an illusion, you know? So it seems like there's another vastu. You know, like for them, there's only one, only Brahma. So anyway, so that is their teaching. So therefore we say, according to them, Jiva and Bhagavan, also bhakti, you know, they are temporary. Because that requires, when it's bhakti, meaning some activity for Bhagavan. When you say Bhagavan, there's like a person, like a supreme person. It's like for them, it doesn't exist. There's no person, you know, only Brahma, like a white light. So, therefore, that whole in their teaching, they said in the beginning you need to do some bhakti, but this is temporary. It's only just for purification. And then later on, when you finally realize the truth, then you're liberated. No more. No more bhakti, no more this concept of Bhagavan, only Brahma, like this. So, is that right? You agree to their teaching, their conception? No, why?
They but, don't know this only. They don't know beyond that.
They don't know, but there is this Brahma Jyoti. It exists though, the Brahma Jyoti. But that's only like the outer covering of Bhagavan. That's a personal manifestation of Bhagavan. It also exists. And those who are like Brahma bodies, but they're not offensive, you know? They actually can go there, but and that's one type of liberation. And beyond that is going by Kulta. Having the same form as Narayan, living with Narayan, having the same wealth, like Narayan, like that. But those are different types of liberation. But that kind of liberation where you merge in the white light and you lost your individuality, like what's happiness at that moment? And it's like spiritual suicide, like this. And even that is not permanent. At some point, because we are by nature, like individual and bound to have some relation and activities. At some point, one has to get out from that position, you know. Then you can again go to the material world and again samsara. So, but that could take a long time, like this, very long time. But those who are like my body is more offensive, they won't even reach that version of the world. They go to a very, they can go to some hell, you know, or some like very low type of like consciousness, species of life. Can be some gem, like a certain type of stone. Anyway, so Bhaktivinoda Thakur said, considering oneself as a serpent is simply a type of sadhana. The mood of servitorship is not the ultimate goal, that according to them, no. We will not give much time here to any deep discussion of this conception, but briefly, we will say that it is necessary for devotees to completely abandon the association of persons to follow this conception. You following? Said completely abandon the association of persons who follow this conception and who remain indifferent to bhakti. The truth or the philosophical conclusions of bhakti will be minimized by their association, and thus, once bhakti will be weakened. Associated with them, bhakti, with their presence, they will minimize bhakti. Your bhakti will be weakened also. So that is which number? Number 5. You remember that? You should remember, because these are the types of people we should not say. First one is the immoral atheist, then the moral atheist, then the immoral. Is there an immoral atheist? No, there's no immoral atheist. No. So the third one is moral theist. Moral theist. And the fourth one is the hypocrites. Okay? immoral theists.
Yes.
They are hypocrites. You can consider them the immoral theists because they're, you know, they're believe, but they're actually hypocrites. They're doing immorality. Then number five, the impersonalists. Now then number six. Number six, polytheists. Polytheists. So anyway, we'll explain. He said, those who accept many Ishwaras, like many gods, many supreme controllers, they are not one-pointed in their worship. Therefore, by taking a small genre of people such as this, gradually one's faith in bhakti disappears. For example of this one, polytheist. Like in India, and usually this is the idea of many people. All those Hindus, they have so many gods, you know, they worship. Because some people are doing like this. They're, you know, they're worshiping so many demigods. They're not one-pointed, like this. But how are we polytheists? He particularly Thakur just said, oh, don't associate with them. And now that some people is like, what are they worshiping so many gods? They have this god holding flute, and then they have another god, like he has lion face, or another god, like, you know, like a dwarf, like a, so many gods. So, how would you explain?
It's the same person.
This does not go into this category of polytheists. Because ultimately, we're worshipping Krishna. We're worshipping Supreme Person, Bhagavan. But we know Bhagavan has unlimited forms, but he is the same person. Like the moon is only one, but he has many kitties, you know, the moon has many faces, 16 faces. It doesn't mean that there are 16 types, there are 16 moons, there's only one. But how much Shakti is manifest, then that's like one type of that form, but that's him, the same. Okay. So, we're worshipping Krishna, he's Swayam Bhagavan. Now, as far as the others are concerned, like his qualities, they're worshipping, sometimes they acknowledge that Krishna is one of the gods. But then they're worshipping Brahma, they're worshipping Shiva, they're worshipping Ganesh, they're worshipping like Durga, like, and they think they're all equal. Like this, you know. So this is like this situation. What it is? It is imperative for those practicing Vaidhi Bhakti to shun the association of these six types of persons who are opposed to devotional service. What is shun? Avoid. Stay away. Occasionally sitting together in a public assembly or when traveling by rail, sitting together in a boat while crossing a river, bathing together at the same facility or meeting at the same business establishment or market while buying or selling goods is not called association. You understand that? Yeah. Because I said, you shun the association of these six types of people. So then, so they go, oh, I should never like sit with them in the bus, you know? Or like you go to the market and you see one, whoever, you know, and say like, that one is in one of the 6,000 people. Then you never like that, you know? If that is not association just because you're sitting in the same bus, the same train, like this. So what does it mean when you say associating with them? Because that's what it is, no, don't associate with these other people. So, Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he explains, association, in our term is called Sangha, Sangha. So when you say Sangha or association, it means to have loving and personal dealings with each other. So that's what it means. So, there's a slope by Rupa Goswami. Six symptoms of disassociation. ददाति प्रतिगृहाति पूर्णमं प्रति दृश्यते ओं देव जयते शैव सद्गुणां प्रति लक्षणं. When you are dealing with each other in a loving and personal way, then you're engaging in this. What is ladati pratigranati? Giving gifts in charity, receiving gifts in charity, and what else?
Open the heart and receiving prasad.
Like revealing your heart to them,
listen,
or inquiring from them. And the other one is receiving, like feeding them, or accepting prasadam. Okay, feeding them prasad, accepting prasad, like this. So these activities, these affectionate activities, if you do with these six people, then that is undesirable.
For example, if one of these six kind of people come to the temple, is not allowed to give prasad because that is stealing.
Yes, you can give them prasad. You can give them. It is, but it's not. No, we never like. You never see. You will not allow. But you allow the Mayavadi, they come serve prasad.
Serve prasad.
You know, like you didn't know what you think you will allow. No, you never.
They can see but not serve him.
Yeah, they sit there and they prasad them, you can give them. So, said, one should never have this type of sangha with these six types of non-devotees. So that's clear, no? That's clear? So that's the first one. The first one of the, what are we talking about?
The people we have to avoid.
No, we're talking about forbidden activities. So the first one is associating with non-devotees, no? Or people unfavorable to bhakti. So now number two. This is actually called encumbrances. Improper relationships. So what it is, then Bhaktivinoda explains. He said, for devotees, following Vaidhi Bhakti, improper dealings are forbidden activities. So exactly what it is, he said four types. There are four types. Number one, improper dealings with disciples. Number two, improper dealings with companions. Three, improper dealings with servants. And four, improper dealings with friends and relatives. So wait, let's understand. He's explaining now. He said, by making unqualified persons disciples due to being desirous of wealth, fame, or followers, many disturbances within the sampradaya are created. Did you get that? So this is an example of improper dealings, improper relationships. This is the second one. So the first one is regards to disciples. You make disciples out of unqualified people, like this. And usually, the unqualified gurus do like this. Unqualified gurus, they make unqualified disciples. Why the unqualified gurus? Because they only want name, fame, money, and like this. And therefore, they take unqualified disciples. Oh, he may be like a, because he's probably very rich or very famous person, and then the desire is that, yes, if he becomes my disciple, I'll be more famous also. You know, and I'll be rich, he'll give me lots of donations, like this. But that person doesn't even follow regulated principles. And cannot follow also. No problem. You know, I'll give you 100 now. Okay, like this. So, if a suitable recipient is not to be found, a Vaidhi Bhakta will never make a disciple. Okay. It is proper for the devotees of Vaidhi Bhakti to take the association of Shuddha Bhaktas, pure devotees, If one takes the association of materialists or non-devotees, one's devotion will be diminished. Thus, if one does not find even a single companion, then that is okay. So now that's regarding second companion. You know, sometimes you need to have a companion, but is that like make sure your companion is, if possible, a pure devotee or at least a devotee, not a materialist, not any of the first one of the six. And if not, then you go alone, no need companion. So he said, however, one should never take the association of non-devotees, even if, thus if one does not find even a single companion, then it is okay. But never take association of non-devotees. If one needs to have a servant, okay, let's say you need to have a servant, then one should keep a servant who is devoted to the performance of bhakti. Otherwise, there's a chance for inauspiciousness occurring. Okay, so this is actually in regards to like who you're relating to. So one, if ever you take disciples, you know, make sure it's qualified. If you need some companion, make sure it's not any of those six that before mentioned. And then, if ever you need someone to serve, you know, as a servant, maybe you're a grihastha. You need some servant to take care of when you're working, to take care of your kids, something like that. So make sure someone who's devotee, like this. Otherwise, you just hire anyone, you know, like materialist. Then it's a very inauspicious thing to happen. Who knows? You start feeding your kids some meat for, you know, like this. Then, before we make friendship or a new relationship with anyone, so that's number four, no? For good friends. Before we make friendship or a new relationship with anyone, it is important that we first examine their quality of Vaishnavism. If that person lacks devotion, then we should not have any relationship with him or her. Yeah? Never make friendship with non-devotees. That's basically what it is. The first one and these two are related. They're all related, actually. Okay. So, improper relationships. Okay. How does it go? Disciples. Second. Companions. Third. Servants. And fourth. Friends. Number three. You can remember what's the third one?
Servant.
No, I'm talking about the third now. So the first one was association with non-devotees. Second, like improper relationships. And the third one now, these are the list of. Again, these are the list of forbidden activities. Okay, things that you should not do. Yeah. Otherwise, they'll create anarchas. They'll create obstacles. Okay. So then, third one is beginning huge projects. Display us, you know, like over and over. A project or festival that requires excessive wealth, manpower, or endeavor should not be undertaken. This is called over-endeavoring for large projects, and it is following three types. So for this, there are three types. Rupa Goswami has written six things that are, you know, that can destroy bhakti, right? You know that verse?
Yeah.
Who knows? Ajara, prasasta, varjago, niyamagra, jaka sangas, cha, lulyam. Sabe bhakti? Vinasthi. Okay, it can destroy your bhakti. So which one is this one? Prayas. This is prayas. He said there are three types of this. Number one, if the person wishing to perform the task does not have sufficient wealth, then he should not set his hand to the task in question. Understand? Like maybe you want to make a big, you have this whole like a dream ashram that you want. You want a very big ashram, and like you have Goshala, you have all this Greek temple, and Anakunda, like this, and what else is there?
One is a garden.
You have garden, and then...
Because...
parking, and whatever. Like all these places. And you don't have money. You know, you don't have money. You just have that, and so then, so no need to endeavor for that. Because what happens, you start, then you end up like working, you forget about, you know, your sadhana, you forget about Krishna, and only for this. So, that's one. You don't have enough sufficient wealth to do that project. Then, forget that project. Number two, it's different when, okay, you may not have money, and I know many Vaishnavas don't have money, but Krishna provides like all the money, you know, like this. So that's a different story. But even then, they're detached, you know. They're, like at any point, they can just like, oh, we don't have enough money, okay, stop, like that. Then, if really Krishna wants, then Krishna will provide like this. But it's different from the very beginning, no money. Okay, you try, still no money, no coming, but still try, like that. This is over endeavor. Okay, number two. If his lifespan is almost finished, let's say you're already 90 years old, he should not commence a large project. Okay, like already your lifespan is almost over, and now you want a big project like this. Then number three, without assistance of many people or without the chance of people assisting, one should not undertake a large project, as it will be inauspicious and will create an obstacle in one's life. Did you get that? No one is there to help you. No one, he said, there's no assistance from many people. Or there's no chance for others to assist with this. Then you should not undertake that large project, whatever it is. If it is too much trouble to accumulate sufficient wealth or manpower to complete a large temple, religious festival, or ashram, then one should not endeavor to begin such a project. Okay, so that's clear. So now number four. Reading many books and commentaries. Bhagavan Thakur explains, devotees accept devotional literatures and even scriptures concerning topics of jnana and karma if they also follow the devotional conclusions. We should not read small parts of many different literatures and then abandon the reading. You hear that? Upon starting a book, we should complete it. Otherwise, by reading bits from here and there, we will become argumentative speculators. So do you understand what he's telling here?
Yeah.
When he says reading many books and commentaries, it's there for the sake of like reading, to be known that, oh, I've read all these books, like so many books. But actually, you have not read completely each. So you read only a part of this, one part of that. So that means you have not really have the full understanding. And what happens is like some incomplete like this. And then the tendency is like you become like history also, you know? Like this. And here Bhaktivinoda Thakur is that you become an argumentative speculator. Like generally, many people are like that. They cannot reconcile many things. Because they've read only a certain portion. And then sometimes, some other places, they contradict, you know, like whatever is said, like this. And they cannot reconcile it, because they have not fully read or fully understand the topic, like this. And, yeah, and especially if you are to preach to other people, if you got like half knowledge of that, and then you make, usually then we just speculate, mix them all, then you preaching to others, and then yeah, you just can't sleep, many people. So Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he said, like, we read, and really read, like, thoroughly, full understanding. And it's best really if you're reading, like, reading also under guidance. You know, like, some higher Vaishnavas, like, really making you understand, like, deeply the subject. Then this is best. He said, there are some who, when hearing a point, without understanding whether it is good or bad, they begin to contradict it. It is always forbidden for devotees to engage in this type of worthless argument. Understand? Like sometimes you hear something, and you hear some like statement about devotee. You know? And you may have read something, and then immediately like, oh, you try to argue. You're not like hearing, like sometimes you will just say something in context, a certain time, you know? And sometimes even, devotees, they speak by their, like some type of emotion, you know? Like, because they're speaking about a certain topic, and accordingly they have a certain emotion, some bhav, like that. And it may not be according to Siddhanta, like this. And so there's many things like that. You have to reconcile, like this. Sometimes we hear devotees say, like, oh, they're absorbed in all the moods of Raj, you know, like this. And sometimes they will say, like, the Dwarkavasis, they have no love, like that. They have love? And so then you make realize the question, he's wrong, like this, you know. You have to understand that he's saying that in that mood, like in the Vrishvasis, they're absorbing love of Krishna, and then they see, like, this particular like personalities in Dwarka, like, they're not having that kind of love. But it's not. Anyone associates with Krishna, they always have love. Otherwise, how do they associate with Krishna? They may be in Vaikuntha or in Dwarka, like this, they have love. But sometimes you have to understand like the context of the word is saying, then reconcile it, like this. So, he said, it is always forbidden for devotees to engage in this type of worthless argument. These arguments are worthless. This actually, sometimes, you may be discussing Siddhanta, you know, but it's only for the sake of argument. Like, one thing is just to show that I know better than you and this. Huh? So, actually, this is one type of prajapa. You may be talking about, like, some Siddhanta, like this. But the motivation is really to show off, like, oh, I know more than you, and like this. So, then it won't be inspiring to whoever listens. What happened is, it will become like a prajalpa. Prajalpa is meaning, like, nothing to do with bhakti. So, it just enhances all these moods of quarrel, like the mood in Kali Yuga. Like this. So that devotees avoid that. So number five, miserliness. So what it means, Bhaktivinoda explains. This miserliness comes from the word kripanata. Kripanata meaning wretchedness. You heard this word? Kripanata?
Kripanata.
Not kripa, as in, usually kripa means mercy. No.
Kripana.
Kripana, yes, kripana.
No. Miser.
Yeah, miserliness. Kripanata. So, miserliness, then we can understand that now he's telling three types of this. three types of this Tripanatha. Number one, Tripanatha by behavior. Number two, in regards to wealth, concerning wealth. And three, in undergoing difficulty or engaging in hard labor. Okay, let's, he'll explain each one, I think. He said, one should stand up when a Vaishnava approaches and behave with them with great affection and intimacy. This is with regards to behavior. So when he says Kripanata or miserliness in behavior, meaning he doesn't behave like properly, you know? No etiquette to others. Very miserly by behavior. So he said one who has no this miserliness with behavior, he stand up when a Vaishnava approaches. Behave with them with great affection and intimacy, like that. Some people are just selfish. They won't even say their pronoun. They don't even smile like this. You know when Vaishnavas come and you don't become happy, this is already aparad. You know, this is one of the six things that consider Vaishnava aparad. Like hanti meaning to beat them or to kill them. Hanti, ninda, like criticize, blaspheme them, they're in that category, the same category of Vaishnava aparad. Hanti, nanti, why dvesh, dvesh meaning become envious, which they, to not welcome them, navinandati, to not welcome them when they're there, what else is there? Naharsh, krutpurdata, before navinandati, to be angry. Angry to the Vaishnava, then not welcome them when they come, and one and five, six, Maharsha, to be not happy when they are coming. So he said, they behave with them with great affection and intimacy. One should behave with the Brahmins by giving them respect and gifts. One should behave with one's dependents by giving them appropriate gifts of clothing and foodstuffs. One should give the proper price for goods obtained from others. Like this. These are examples. You know, like some people are very miserly. There's a certain price, and that's fine price, but you want like less, you know? Like, or if you're a seller also, they want more. Selling more. So, one should show gratefulness to benefactors. One should behave properly for donating food grains to the poor, giving medicines to the diseased, and donating cloth to those afflicted by cold. So this is now more on the second one, concerning wealth. You know, like one is behavior and another one is by wealth. You're not miserly in distributing wealth. Donating food grains to the poor, giving medicines to the diseased, and donating cloth to those afflicted by cold. All living entities should be respected, and when one behaves appropriately with everyone, then the fault of miserliness cannot afflict them. Again, there's no fault, there's no miserliness if one is behaving properly, appropriately with everybody. Even if there is nothing to give in his house, listen to this. Because maybe you're poor, you have nothing to give. He said, even if there's nothing to give in his house, then at least he may greet them by speaking sweetly. Like this. So like that, like, if you have guests, you have nothing, like if you have water, then give water, give a seat. If nothing even, just nicely welcome them. You know, like you greet them nicely. One should always behave properly with others. Deal with some by giving sweet speech, some by giving well, or some by giving hard labor. What is that? Deal with some by giving sweet speech, some by giving wealth, or some by giving hard labor. I'm not sure if it's the correct translation.
Maybe working for them.
Ah, you gave them, okay, you are giving them hard labor.
Yes.
Then one should do what is appropriate. Okay. For the devotees, miserliness in behavior is forbidden. Okay, so that's clear. Right? Okay. So then we can continue reading until the Pujari opens. Number 6 now. So 5, you can remember the 5 so far? The 5 forbidden activities. So far we've discussed 5. Association of non-devotees or person of Bhakti. The second is improper relationships. Third, what's third one? This over-endeavoring? Yeah, over-endeavoring. And fourth? Fourth is reading many books and commentaries. And fifth, this miserliness. Kripanata. So now number 6, 4 types of compulsions. So there's another word. What's compulsions? We will read now. It said, allowing oneself to be controlled is a major fault. This can happen in the following 4 different ways. When you're, there's some compulsion, some by force, like something compulsory. So, allowing yourself to be controlled by force. So there are 4 ways, 4 different ways. Number 1, being controlled by grief. By grief. Everyone has grief, no? Grief? Like sorrow, pain. Second, by habit.
By a habit.
You have a certain habit. You know what's a habit, right? Like a certain activity that it's a certain activity that what is that like?
You do all the time.
Second nature.
It became like second nature. Like, you're used to do it, and it's now difficult to stop. So that is compulsion by habit. One is by greed, habit. 3, an intoxicant. And 4, a superstition. He'll explain. So number 1, to be controlled by greed. For anyone currently within this material world, there will be millions of reasons to feel lamentation, agitation, anger, greed, and bewilderment. That's normal in the material world. It is normal. We have to understand that. However, the devotee of Vaidhi Bhakti will not become controlled by lamentation even when those reasons are present. Okay, there may be reasons to really be like something really lamentable, but the devotee, they will not be controlled by this. By lamenting, one becomes weakened, and it becomes an obstacle in the cultivation of devotion. One should remain cautious in this regard. You understand? Sometimes it can come in many ways. Like it may come by your being like introspective and I have not advanced in bhakti, or I still have like so many faults and like that. It may even like that kind of grief. Which is good, like you're introspective. But then you don't get controlled by this as if like the whole day will pass and you're just like, I'm so bad, you're not chanting, nothing. And you're just going depressed and like that. So, we don't get control. Number 2, to be controlled by bad habits. Okay, listen to this. To sleep in the daytime or during the early morning, to eat untimely, to eat unnecessarily, to pass through or bathe untimely, to sleep on a luxurious bed, or to eat luxurious preparations are bad habits. Looking at that, we're telling directly, these are bad habits. Listening? you're not listening because you're sleeping.
I haven't.
So, listen, Sean. He said, to sleep in the daytime. Especially to sleep during Harimata. Or during the early morning, he says. To eat untimely or to eat unnecessarily. Sometimes some people, they're not really hungry, but unnecessarily they just eat. It's a type of some maybe depression. Then to pass through or bathe untimely also. To sleep on a luxurious bed or to eat luxurious preparations. They are bad habits, like you're telling. But we're never telling this. To be controlled by these bad habits will cause great suffering in the end. To accept only what is absolutely necessary for maintaining one's life ensures us of never being controlled by unnecessary habits. Fine. And that's why we do vratas. You know, we do vratas like now, we're making shabu vrata, we're doing all these different vratas, and Vaishnavas are very expert in, you know, inspiring us, oh, we do this vrata. And what is really helping us is like they're making us become free from all these bad habits. Otherwise, sometimes, you know, if there's no vrata, then there's no like special, yeah, like stimulus or special like encouragement, like, I should join the kirtan tomorrow because we have all these Kishan vrata kirtans that we should sing every day. Or like Kartik, you know, we do Kartik vrata. So, generally people don't like to, kirtan in the morning or like this. They just sleep. But then, because vrata is there, they go, tomorrow, now we're beginning kirtan, now Kartik. And we have all these like, kirtans to sing, all these ashvatams. So then, they forget all these bad habits and they engage in all these various religious activities. But, if you don't give up these bad habits, at least even Vaishnavas are helping you, then what happens? Yeah, now you're following this fault, being controlled by bad habits, like this. So, and generally, if you look at these bad habits, it refers to something about eating, something about sleeping. Eating, sleeping, mainly on these topics. And if you look at vratas, they're mainly also just for this one. They're targeting the eating and sleeping, like this. So number three, to be controlled by intoxications. By taking up intoxicants, you know intoxicants, no? Many kinds of unwanted desires, many anarthas arise. Upon becoming controlled by these substances, bhakti becomes contaminated. What to speak of alcohol, marijuana, opium, hashish, and hemp, even cigarettes, chewing tobacco, and betel nut is never to be taken by Vaishnavas. Who is doing tobacco here? Cigarettes? But someone they went to the it is forbidden in the devotional scriptures to take these substances. By imbibing tobacco in the form of cigarettes and cigars, the tongue becomes completely addicted. It may take one so far that one becomes pressed to associate with unfavorable persons and remain in evil company. Because of these things, you can become forced to take association of very bad company just because now you're addicted to these things. It's the same principle. Of course, these are intoxications, but even something not intoxicating, something like very favorable for the senses, you know? And some people get attached to this taste of whatever, and then some materialists are offering that. Oh, nice. When you also go there, because you're attached to that, and then you're taking. But especially if maybe you're addicted, then, out of control. And then you go all the way, even, it doesn't matter, you associate with and all these evil people to get satisfaction and joy. So that's number three. Yeah. And fourth one, last. To be controlled by narrow-mindedness, or we call superstitions. Superstition. To be controlled by narrow-mindedness is a major disturbance. From this, prejudice awakens. When prejudice awakens, the inclination or respect for the truth does not stay within the heart. So when you say prejudice, what does it mean? Prejudice. When someone is narrow-minded, then you have prejudice. Okay, now it's so late, and now our third open. We're up to here, then the fourth one. We'll continue tomorrow. We'll take from here. You can also find out about this, what is prejudice. Okay, that's the good day. Thank you.